Hi, everyone. Welcome to another episode of the Data Standard Audio Experience. I'm your host, Catherine Tao. And today we have another exciting guest. We have Andrew Custage, the Senior Director of Analytics for Sense 360 at Medallia. And today we're going to be speaking about how COVID has impacted the data industry. So welcome to the show, Andrew.
Thanks so much for having me, Catherine.
Yeah, definitely. Thank you so much for being on the show. And go ahead, can you introduce yourself and tell us more about your experiences?
Sure. Yeah. So I run the analytics department for Sense 360. And what we do is market research. And prior to last year, we were a growing startup in the market research space and were acquired by Medallia back in September. And what we do at Sense 360 is we use some newer data sets for the market research world that go beyond just the typical survey data, which has historically been the foundation of market research. And we do surveys as well, but a lot of our insights are based on also using foot traffic data from a panel of smartphones that we track their location and we can see where they visit. And then additionally, also, we use a lot of credit and debit card data from a panel that allows us to see how people are spending their dollars and where they're spending their money. And in particular, my role on the analytics team is to support Sense 360's clients with custom analyses and reports on a variety of topics, usually things related to what's going on in the market and also what actions our clients can take to improve their performance as a brand.
Yeah, that sounds great. And it sounds like you're very also passionate about the area that you're working in. So that's great to hear. And the big topic today is just talking more about how COVID has really impacted everything in with just all the work. And so how has COVID changed market research and use cases?
Oh, it's really changed it a ton. Maybe it's been one of the most dramatic shifts ever. When you think about just as far as how much society has changed over the last year, I feel like the last time we've had anything of this magnitude, like the Spanish flu 100 years ago, or the last time we had a world war or anything, market research didn't exist in the form that it does now. So from a big data and a market research perspective, this has probably been the biggest shift we've ever seen in consumer behavior and sentiments and just in general, the way people engage with brands. And it's been both crazy in a lot of ways, but also really interesting. And it's presented the opportunity to do some really cool market research that's never been done before. I would say if I had to think in particular about some of the ways that it's really changed things the most, one of them would be the increased need for quick, near real-time pulses on what's going on in the market. When you think about the way market research used to be done, a lot of lengthy surveys, it takes a lot of time to collect results and to analyze results. And you might not know what's happening or what people are thinking until weeks or months after the fact. But now with a lot of these newer market research data sets like foot traffic tracking and credit and debit card transaction tracking, we can see things happen in a really quick turnaround time, sometimes even just a matter of a couple of days. And when you think about how COVID's changed the world and the first time anything happens in the COVID era, the first time a state changes their policies on social distancing, the first time there's a holiday during COVID, the first time there's a major weather event during COVID, and so on and so forth, there's a need for brands to really quickly understand whether they should change their actions or learn from what's working well on what competitors are doing. And they don't have weeks or months to implement those changes. In order to really see the results well, they need to make that decision in a matter of days and weeks. And having that information has become more important than ever. And when you think about how to collect that data, the reason why using data sets beyond just surveys are important too is because people don't really know how their behavior is going to change over the course of COVID or when COVID finally ends. So seeing precisely how they actually have been behaving with observed data, like where they go and what they buy, is a lot more powerful than just what they say or what they think. But as far as what they say or what they think, this has also been a very interesting time period because beyond just understanding how brands can change their pricing or their product lines or the types of things that research was done before on, now there's the opportunity to do research and understand how people would respond to much more dramatic changes to the experience and the operations of how they engage with brands. When you think about new cleanliness standards or new service models on how people buy things and receive the product, all that's changing and research is needed for all of it.
Yeah, definitely. And it sounds like you brought up a lot of good points of how things could change, like the cleanliness. And that's not something that people had to think about as sharply or as in depth before COVID happened. So, yeah, great insight and great just explanations and definitely. And so you've talked a lot about how COVID has really changed the market research and all of its use cases as well. And I wanted to also know about the data itself. So how has the data changed in market research?
Yeah, I would say in a couple of ways. One would be the intent behind what data is collected, I would say, has changed a bit, where there's a lot more of a need to collect more granular and local sample as opposed to just a national or worldwide finding. And the reason for that is because within the US, the country as a whole has not behaved the same during the course of COVID everywhere. We've seen really big differences in how people have spent their dollars and where they're going, or how often they're even leaving their home, depending on whether they live in more urban versus rural locations, or in different regions of the country, like the Southeast versus the Northeast or the West Coast. And we've actually found that even one of the biggest drivers in how restaurants and retailers have performed during COVID is simply where in the country they have their locations, as opposed to them actually employing any different strategy that worked well or not well once COVID began. It's almost as if for a lot of brands, their fate was sealed just based on whether they were lucky or unlucky and where they had their locations. And it's just did certainly changed the focus on deriving insights that are different across the country and collecting enough data and enough sample to do that. And one other thing that's really changed too is more from a technical perspective is how panels are actually managed and having consistency and integrity within a panel. When you think about using an independent consumer research panel for market research, there's a very different set of considerations versus if you're analyzing data that is straight from an internal source of truth, like a company's own sales data. In order to track the performance of brands when you're using an independent research panel, consistency on who makes up that panel is really important, and having the proper controls to be representative over time, even as individual panelists churn in and out, is it's a really big undertaking. And when you look at some of the main demographic controls to be representative of looking at things like employment status or home environment, it became really hard early on during COVID to know what to reference it against because old census data definitely was not the standard anymore as people's home environments and their employment status were changing so dramatically. And even just in our case, looking at foot traffic data, having controls on who's active in our foot traffic panel was an undertaking that we really had to go through. If somebody hasn't left their home in a week during COVID because they've been quarantining, like, how do you still know that they're actually active as a foot traffic panelist? And these were a lot of things that we really had to explore deeply in our panel and ensure whether we had the proper controls set up.
Yeah, definitely. And it sounds like there's been a lot of just changes throughout the data itself. So thank you so much for sharing this. COVID has made many companies go remote overnight, and it was a very sudden, quick change for many different companies. And so how did your team and company kind of handle this sudden change?
Well, for us, it was really interesting because our main client base historically, and as we grew as a company, was around the restaurant sector and also some retail and packaged goods and many other brands too. But really, a big focus for us up until a year or two ago was on restaurants. And even today, a large percent of our client base is still restaurants. And obviously, the restaurant sector has been one of the hardest hit by COVID by far. And this developed a pretty mixed reaction from our clients. So there are some companies and some clients we had that really had to shut down all of their locations because of the quarantine-oriented rules in their states and localities where they had locations. And we did lose some clients as a result. So it obviously was a struggle for us too, but it also presented a big opportunity because a lot of brands, especially restaurant brands, really leaned into this paradigm shift of the industry and recognized that now more than ever, there's a need to have a rapid pulse on what's going on in the market and how consumers are thinking. And We actually were happy to say over the course of COVID achieved a really healthy amount of growth and added a lot of new clients because of this new need for research and our ability to fulfill on it. And I would say one of the biggest decisions we made as a company was to double down on getting our name out there with thought leadership. Before COVID, in particular, our analytics team that I'm a part of was really focused on serving existing clients with research projects. And we sustained that need, but also intentionally carved out a lot of time to create public content too, that wasn't for just any one client, but we would put out there via webinars and blog posts. And we started actually about a week into COVID doing daily webinars, and we're still a year in doing them weekly every Tuesday with the latest tracking on how the market's performing during COVID and how consumer sentiments are shifting too. And really this shift for us on having a more active approach and thought leadership was really important in exposing us to prospective clients who hadn't known about us beforehand. And because we were able to show insights quicker and deeper than a lot of the things we were seeing from other bigger market research firms out there, this helped us land a lot of new clients in the process. And I would say another big shift of how we responded to COVID was our acquisition by Medallia. And Medallia has really amazing capabilities with customer experience and employee experience platforms and services. And when you think about what we can provide and now being part of Medallia, what they can provide too, we have the ability to provide at Sense360 a view into what's going on in the broader market. And then now that we can pair that with a really deep understanding from Medallia of what a company has going on within their own four walls and with their own customers, we have a really well-rounded view of the data points that help brands make some of the biggest decisions that they could be making right now in this environment.
Yeah, definitely. It sounds like a lot of just customer partnerships has changed a lot due to COVID with your company. And it's interesting to hear about all these changes. And there's just so many different moving parts to think about now in terms of just business and doing and all these companies, definitely. And for your specific position as a director, part of your job is just going through the hiring process and finding new talent to fill the gaps within your company and seeing where things need to be helped or things need to be done efficiently. And so how has the hiring process been impacted with everything being remote, since I'm sure there's been a lot of changes for the hiring process now?
Yeah, it's definitely been a big change for us, because prior to COVID, I would say a big part of our interview process and our recruitment process were things like in-person interviews and having the opportunity for the candidate to meet a large percent of the team that they would be working with before we ever got to a point of making an offer or having that candidate decide if they wanted to come join Sense360. So it's been challenging for a couple of reasons. I would say both because of that and because it's harder to use culture as a selling point in recruiting. It's harder to show candidates some of the more tangible elements of culture that used to exist beforehand, like the office environment and the perks that come with working at a company like ours. We can't do something like bringing in a candidate for interviews now and having them see people play ping pong during lunch in our office. We really have to rely on the selling points of the value of the work and the team that they'd be working with to show people that this is a job worth taking. And I believe it has worked well. We've brought on some amazing people during this environment, and they've essentially only interacted with a lot of their teammates remotely since joining. And even in the process of interviewing too, we also made a lot of other changes. Like, we slimmed down our interview process to avoid Zoom fatigue. And that's actually turned into work out pretty well too. We realized that a lot of the assessments and questions we were asking over the course of multiple rounds of interviews were tackling the same thing over and over again. And that redundancy wasn't really necessary or fair to the candidate from a time perspective. And we've definitely also changed our search approach too, of not being as strict on where a person lives. We used to recruit just for our home office for Los Angeles based positions, but we've now been, at least on my team, opening up searches to allow remote work anywhere. And we really don't have the productivity concern of somebody not being in an office the way that we would have before COVID began.
Yeah, definitely. And it's very clear that a lot of things have changed throughout the interview process for your team. And that's good that you were able to find just the redundancy from the past way and just kind of shorten the process a bit just to make it more efficient and more cohesive. So that's definitely great. And do you think that your company will continue, you know, post-COVID to be working in a remote environment, or will it be a hybrid version? What are your thoughts on that?
I would say our expectation right now, although we haven't finalized anything, is that it will be more of a hybrid model where certainly a lot more of the team will be completely remote and not based in our home office in LA. But even for the people that are based in LA, likely the mandatory 5 days a week in office model is going to feel outdated to us. And I think we'll probably have a more flex or hotel-like approach of a few days a week, scheduling around when other people on your team are going to be in the office and planning certain in-person meetings to be on those days of the week, and then a little bit more independent work time on the remote days. Things could change between now and when we ultimately return to an office, but I would say that's at least our expectation at the moment.
Yeah, definitely. And that sounds like a very common answer I've heard from speaking to a lot of guests on the podcast, saying that it'll be either entirely remote or there'll be a hybrid version. But I haven't really heard many companies say that they will completely go back to working again in person. But it's interesting to see how COVID has really impacted work in general like that, just kind of changing the entire format like that. You touched on company culture a bit earlier throughout the interview process and hiring process, but how are you continuing to maintain this team culture with everything being remote right now?
Yeah, I don't think we're doing it perfectly. I don't know if any company is, but if there are things that you've heard of others doing well, I'd love to know about them and see if we can learn from it too. But at least as far as what we're trying and what we're doing, I think some of the bigger things are having more opportunities for feedback directly from team members, sometimes in open forums and then sometimes anonymously with a feedback form is key, and ensuring that people still have the opportunity to be heard on what they're looking for with culture, I think is important. Some people are looking to essentially find fun, friend-oriented activities with their colleagues and are willing to do them remotely. Some people would define culture in a different manner and, you know, another Zoom call, but this time it's for a fun topic instead of work, isn't their idea of culture anymore. And I think it really depends on the person, but at least we've tried to have a variety of things. We've done some company-wide fitness challenges where people are remotely tracking their steps and things like that. We've done online poker games. We've had a couple of socially distanced picnics in parks too. And dedicating some time for non-work discussions. It is admittedly over a Zoom call, but at least some things like in our analytics team stand-ups, we'll have a recurring set of pop culture topics or other things that people will bring in and provide their point of view. So we've had basically team polls and debates on like the best Thanksgiving side dish or the most underrated band, or we actually just yesterday had a discussion about what conspiracy theories people think actually might have some merit to them. So it can be any random thing, but at least something that allows people to get the dialogue going outside of regular project work. I would say another thing that we found has been really helpful too is to intentionally do some things that don't exist anymore without having people sit next to each other in an office, but are still a necessary part of people sharing work and training each other. So one really big revelation we had was the power of people recording things on their screen and actually narrating like point and click instructions when they're training somebody else on the team has been so much better than just writing something in a Word document with written instructions. And actually being able to hear somebody and narrate step by step and watch what they do has been the closest thing that we can get to actually having somebody sit next to somebody else and shadow them as they're learning how to do the job. And then even also just scheduling sessions for people to do nothing other than share interesting things that they've been working on and provide links of, you know, helpful references and things like that to other team members so that they could use it in their work, I would say has been a really, really big productivity help for us.
Yeah, definitely. And I really like how you mentioned there's kind of like that team dialogue session where you all talk about some type of topic outside of work. I think that makes just work really fun, and you get to really know your team as well. And it's just a fun way to get to know your team. So that's a great way to kind of build the team culture and continue that. And I think I might also start adopting that to our team too, since it sounds like such a great idea. But yeah. And I wanted to say thank you so much, Andrew, for joining us today. It was such a pleasure to have you. We at the Data Standard, we're trying to build a community where everyone can network and collaborate with the like-minded individuals. So what is something that we can do for you?
Well, I would say we're always looking for new ideas and offerings with new data sets. And while a lot of our offerings today are based around foot traffic data and credit card and debit card transaction data and surveys, there's certainly a lot of other things out there around receipt panels, social listening data, weather data, search data, things that we haven't fully incorporated into our offerings yet, and would always love to hear from others things that they've found useful or that they're using today. And we also are a growing company, so if anybody listening is interested in working with us, certainly check us out on our website and see if there are any open roles that might interest you.
Yeah, sounds perfect. And where can everyone find you online to connect with you?
I'm on LinkedIn. You can just search for my name, Andrew Custage, C-U-S-T-A-G-E. Also at sense360.com, you can find a lot of our previous blog posts and webinar content, and you can also sign up to join us for future webinars. There's a calendar of dates and topics on our website, but it's typically Tuesdays at 9:30 to 10 a.m. Pacific time.
For more information on the Data Standard, you can find us at www.datastandard.io, as well as on our LinkedIn and YouTube channel. And thank you so much, Andrew, for joining us. Such a pleasure to have you on the show today and just learning more about your perspective on this kind of remote environment and how COVID has really impacted everything. So thanks so much for being on the show.
Thanks so much for having me, Catherine.